So my presentation is called Shoot to Kill, State Violence in the Making of the Illinois Black Panther Party. I'm going to begin with the assassination of Fred Hampton. At approximately 4:30 a.m. on December 4th, 1969, Chicago police and federal agents burst into the apartment of Fred Hampton, the charismatic 21-year-old leader of the Illinois Black Panther Party, and murdered him as he slept next to his pregnant wife. Police also killed the 22-year-old leader of the Black Panthers in Peoria, Illinois, Mark Clark, and injured four other Panthers, and arrest everyone who was not dead in the apartment. Only two police officers were injured, one grazed on the leg by a shotgun pellet, and another cut his hand on a piece of glass. Initially, the police justified the killings, claiming that the occupants fired first. Edward V. Hanoran, the Cook County State's Attorney, told the media, "The immediate violent criminal reaction of the occupants in shooting at announced police officers emphasizes the extreme viciousness of the Black Panther Party. So does their refusal to cease firing at the police officers when urged to do so several times." However, flaws and inconsistencies in the police's narrative became apparent to the public as activists investigated the crime scene, fueling public distrust of the police. Hampton's close friend, Bobby Rush, along with several other Panthers, gave tours of the apartment where the supposed shootout occurred. People discovered when they got there, according to the New York Times, that many walls and entire rooms have no visible scars, and that most of the bullets are clustered in the areas where the Panthers were shot. In fact, many of the bullet holes that were shown in pictures of the shootout were just nails made to look like bullet holes. The murder of Fred Hampton and the attempted cover-up by the city of Chicago represents one of the most egregious examples of state violence committed against the Black community in Chicago, but certainly not the only instance. Today, just to give you an outline of what I'm going to talk about, I'm going to begin with common portrayals of the Illinois Black Panther Party, and I'll call them the ILBPP for short. And I'll be talking about some popular portrayals in mass media of them, as well as what recent scholarship has said. Next, I will move into the political machine of Mayor Richard J. Daley, who ran Chicago politics from the 1950s to his death in 1976. After that, I'll move into one of the specific operations of the political machine, which was police brutality, looking specifically at the history of Daley's infamous shoot to kill order, where he gave police the order to shoot and kill rioters. And I'll also look at the 1968 riots that followed at Martin Luther King Jr.'s death. And then after looking at specific instances of police brutality, I will go to police brutality against the Black community. I will look at instance of police brutality against the white community in Chicago that received a lot of headlines and really called media attention to police brutality in Chicago with the 1968 Democratic National Convention. Now, civil rights activists throughout the 1950s, 1960s viewed police brutality as one of their primary concerns. In fact, the murder of Jimmie Lee Jackson at the hands of an Alabama police officer helped spark the Selma to Montgomery March in 1965. In 1966, Huey Newton and Bobby Seale founded the Black Panther Party for self-defense in response to police brutality. Initially restricted to the Bay Area, the Black Panther Party grew throughout the late 1960s, opening chapters in 20 cities across the United States, including Los Angeles, Seattle, New York, Detroit, Des Moines, Indianapolis, and Chicago. The Black Panther Party chapter in Chicago formed in 1968, surrounded by a political atmosphere marked by the state violence characteristic of Mayor Richard J. Daley's Democratic machine. Furthermore, the ILBPP was formed in 1968 amidst the dramatic, violent political upheavals in America that occurred that year. Police repression in Chicago in 1968 became incredibly violent as protests and riots consumed the city following the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King. The violence continued throughout the summer, culminating during the 1968 Democratic National Convention. The political atmosphere in Chicago in 1968 and the state violence emanating from it shaped many features of the local Black Panther Party there, including their politics of racial coalition building, as well as their anti-police rhetoric. The brutal violence used by state authorities to bring down the Black Panther Party is now well known. In fact, within the last year, there have been two blockbuster movies released which portrayed the events in Chicago. The first, The Trial of Chicago 7, directed by Aaron Sorkin, depicts the trial of eight leaders of activist organizations. Notoriously, the court dropped charges against one of the eight, Black Panther co-founder Bobby Seale, because Judge Julius Hoffman ordered the police to bound and gag him. The Panthers appear in The Trial of the Chicago 7 as an entity entirely separate from the other organizations on trial, with little to no connection, except for a five-minute speech given to Bobby Seale. On the other hand, Judas and the Black Messiah, directed by Shaka King, brilliantly and accurately depicts the tragic story of Fred Hampton and FBI informant William O'Neill, who befriended and betrayed Hampton. The film does not depict events before the formation of the ILBPP, however, and the primary plotline revolves around specific violent episodes between the police and the Panthers. These two movies exemplify the public memory of both the 1968 Democratic National Convention and the history of the ILBPP, where the two are seen as two disconnected histories characterized solely by violence. The literature on the two events also follows this popular perception. For example, only four pages in Jacoby Williams's book on the Illinois Black Panthers, From the Bullet to the Ballot, represents the most extensive study on the influence of the Panthers on the Democratic National Convention. When scholars analyze violence in the histories of the Black Panthers, most focus on the self-defense tactics of the party, or the cases in which police officers and government agents brutalized and killed Panthers. Some other scholars not only look at physical violence committed by state officials, but also considered poverty and the conditions surrounding it as a form of violence in itself. For instance, Curtis J. Austin, in his book, Up Against the Wall, credits the violence of dilapidated housing, long-term unemployment, and inadequate education, along with police brutality, as the factors that prompted the formation and growth of the Black Panther Party. However, the majority of Austin's work focuses on the party's tactic of self-defense. According to Austin, media coverage of the self-defense tactic was a double-edged sword for the Black Panther Party, as it helped the party to recruit, but it also caused a vehement reaction from the government, especially the police and FBI. The only work which analyzes the Chicago Black Panthers through the lens of other forms of violence is a recent article by Antonio R. Lopez titled, We Know What the Pigs Don't Like. Lopez recasts the original Rainbow Coalition formed in Chicago as a political strategy that opposed threats to urban renewal and post-industrial economic growth. In a sense, Lopez argues that activists formed the Rainbow Coalition in response to population violence, meaning the factors and policies which caused poverty and migration to and within Chicago. Adding on to the work done by Austin and Lopez and Williams, I analyzed the impact that state violence had on the local level in shaping the tactics and rhetoric of the Black Panther Party. Rather than focusing on the violence of poverty, which I have done in other research, I instead have decided to focus solely on police brutality because the local politics surrounding the police in Chicago explains some of the local variations in the ILBPP's rhetoric and action. The Democratic political machine in Chicago relied on physical violence to maintain power. Mayor Richard J. Daley dominated Chicago politics as chairman and mayor of the Cook County of Chicago. From 1953 till his death in 1976. As one historian summed up black life under the Daley Democratic machine, Black life in Chicago could be fairly characterized as poor, angry, and underserved. On top of maintaining racial residential segregation and displacing over 100,000 poor African Americans through the construction of expressways and housing projects, Daley and the city's ward bosses attempted to control the Black population through the tactics of mafia violence and police brutality. The brutal murder of the West Side's first Black alderman, Benjamin F. Lewis, best represents these mafia tactics. As alderman, Lewis challenged former committeeman Arthur Elrod's insurance business, which Elrod used to pressure businesses seeking a liquor license to buy insurance from him. Just days after his re-election in 1963, a janitor found Lewis's dead body in a pool of blood. He was handcuffed to the floor, and there were three bullets in the back of his head. The Chicago Defender called Lewis's murder a political execution, and although the investigators never found the murderers, most African-American activists in Chicago believed that the police and the party bosses killed Lewis. Besides the mafia tactics, Daley also used the police force to control and strike fear into the Black community. Police brutality in Chicago, as well as most other places in the United States, was a constant feature of life for African Americans. In 1960s Chicago, however, the police force had direct ties to the political machine, as the process to become a police officer in Chicago usually required the approval of the local ward committeeman, who was usually the alderman, and the job holder was therefore often beholden to that ward officer. Police districts typically shared the same borders as the city's wards, which meant that almost every ward boss got to pick a station commander and many of the men under him. And as you see here, I have a map of Chicago up with all the wards, so you would know, so you could see kind of what it looks like. Journalist Mike Royko documented numerous instances of police corruption and brutality in his book, Boss. Among the corrupt actions that Royko notes includes police officers taking bribes from motorists and prostitution rings, ignoring a bleeding Black man who walked into the police department asking for help, stealing off of dead bodies, and beating up suspects with phone books so as to not leave marks. As expected, poor African Americans bore the brunt of police brutality. While African Americans roughly consisted of 1/3 of Chicago's population, over half of those arrested were Black. In surveying documented cases of police brutality in the African-American newspaper, The Chicago Defender, historian John Rice found complaints of abusive language, arbitrary arrests, searches without provocation, torturing of arrestees, refusal to assist people in distress, and laxness in arresting certain criminals. As one Black Chicagoan expressed to Royko, a person could be walking down the street, minding his own business, and a cop grabs him, shakes him, throws him in the car. According to the man, 12 of his friends were arrested just the previous week that way. Mayor Daley's shoot-to-kill order, given during the riots that followed the assassination of Martin Luther King on April 4, 1968, exemplifies his disregard for Black life. Shoot-to-kill orders originated in U.S. history in retaliation to the strikes and marches of the labor movement during the Gilded Age, usually given to militia members firing upon strikers. The first instance of such an order appeared in Milwaukee during the Great Upheaval of 1886, where militiamen were ordered to fire at members of the Knights of Labor. Shoot-to-kill orders also appeared in Chicago during the Great Railroad Strike of 1894. In the aftermath of the Civil Rights Movement and the urban uprisings of the 1960s, calls for a shoot-to-kill order grew along with the cry for law and order, albeit shoot-to-kill represented the more minor and extreme opinion. In 1966, a gubernatorial candidate in Tennessee, hoping to emulate George Wallace and Lester Maddox, stated that he would give orders for cops to shoot to kill rioters. And just months before Daley's order, a temporary commission on the revision of the penal code in New York State recommended the passage of legislation to expand the authority of policemen and private citizens to shoot to kill when they are in fear of the use of such force by burglary or arson suspects. As all these previous examples demonstrate, officials rarely issued shoot-to-kill orders in response to actual threats on police officers' lives, but instead to maintain political power and order. In fact, according to Royko, upon hearing about King's assassination, the police concentrated their strength in Chicago's Loop to protect the stores and businesses there should African Americans come downtown for revenge. Daley's shoot-to-kill order came immediately after seeing the property damage and the fires caused by the riot as he flew over the city in his helicopter. Then, after an angry conversation over the phone with the superintendent of police, James Conlisk, Daley decided to hold a press conference. There, Daley told the press that he instructed an order be issued by Conlisk immediately and under his signature to shoot to kill any arsonist or anyone with a Molotov cocktail in his hand. Daley also told Conlisk to issue a police order to shoot to maim or cripple anyone looting any stores. When a reporter asked, "What about children?" he responded, "You wouldn't want to shoot children, but with mace, you can detain youngsters." He expressed his anger with Conlisk for not issuing the order himself, saying, "I was disappointed to know that every policeman out on his beat was supposed to use his own discretion." Conlisk actually never ordered the issue, and after immense backlash from just about everybody to the left of Barry Goldwater, Daley slowly walked back his statements. However, he remained prideful of the support the order received from letters and telegrams to his office. The riots demonstrated the growing frustration within the Black community at the Daley political machine. The 1968 race riots in Chicago occurred on the west side, not the south side. The difference, as pointed out by Royko, the south side had leaders, and the leaders were Black. On the west side, all the aldermen, both white and Black, took their orders from their white wealthy ward bosses who donated heavily to the Daley political machine. As expected, the wealthy ward bosses did not have the best interests of the communities they ran in mind. For instance, Erwin Horwitz ran the 24th Ward, but only wanted white people as precinct captains, despite the heavily Black population in his ward. As according to Royko, Horwitz said, "Blacks could not handle the job." Such sentiments within the Daley machine, along with the persistence of poverty and police brutality, caused people in Black communities to lash out against the system through Black power activism or even rioting. The Black Panthers sought to channel the Black community's anger at the police into a revolutionary force. The Chicago Panthers, like other proponents of Black power, viewed their struggle as a decolonial struggle. In the words of Kwame Ture, formerly known as Stokely Carmichael, and Charles B. Hamilton, Black power theorists often believed that Black people in this country form a colony and it is not in the interest of the colonial power to liberate them. According to Ture and Hamilton, white wealthy people in America politically and economically exploit African-American communities like Europeans did to African colonies. They argued that the government system, including social welfare, solely exists to extract profit and create dependency in poor Black communities. Black power advocates, especially the Black Panthers, argued for the self-determination of Black communities. In Chicago, this meant that the people, not the political machine, ought to choose the candidates for public office, and that the police officers from the community come from the communities they serve. Franz Fanon, who Black power activists, including the Black Panthers, frequently read, argued that when police officers do not come from the community and brutalize the local population, they become the physical embodiment of the regime of oppression and thus uses a language of pure violence. Fanon thus summarizes the decolonial struggle as destroying the system with violence. He says, "The violence which governed the ordering of the colonial world will be vindicated and appropriated when, taking history into their own hands, the colonized blow the colonial world to smithereens. The Black Panthers viewed white police officers in their neighborhoods in a similar vein. In a speech given at North Illinois University just 1 month before his assassination, titled, "It's a Class Struggle, Goddammit," Fred Hampton laid out his political philosophy, which lay at the core of the ILBPP's beliefs. He believed that the oppressor existed in three tiers: businessmen, politicians, and lastly, the police. Hampton emphasized class because in the third tier of oppression existed Black police officers who also brutalized the Black community. Hampton labeled Black police officers as the descendants of Benedict Arnold and called them jackanapes in the community, allowed to remain there only because of their skin complexion. In fact, Hampton explicitly called out Gloves Davies, one of the police officers who later participated in his assassination, as a Benedict Arnold. Without destroying the capitalist system, Hampton feared that Black Americans would replicate a system similar to Papa Doc Duvier's in Haiti, where he got all the, where according to Hamilton, Hampton, he got all the white folks out and now he's oppressing all the Black folks. When talking about the Vietnam War, Hampton stated that he believed that the aggressor needs to be driven out of both Vietnam and Black America. In a fashion similar to Fanon's analysis, Hampton stated that the police come into our communities and occupy our communities like troops occupy a foreign territory. Throughout his speech, Hampton referenced the police murder of Michael Soto, using it to illustrate how the police occupy Black communities and declare war on the community. On October 10th, 1969, police shot and killed Michael Soto at Henry Horner Projects on the West Side for an alleged attempted robbery. Soto, a US soldier, just came home from fighting in Vietnam to attend a 16-year-old brother's funeral, who the cops also killed weeks before. The cops claimed that they saw Soto and two other men attempt to rob someone in an alleyway. So they chased him into a high-rise building, and there they shot him on the first floor, claiming self-defense. The robbery victim also ran away. After the killing, a crowd of over 100 people grew on the first floor of the building, including Soto's mother, who cried out, "You killed two of my sons. How many more are you going to kill?" The crowd became increasingly agitated, and when police attempted to remove Soto's body from the building, the tenants barred the door shut, and then shotguns, pistols, and rifles fired upon the police from the second and fifth floors. The Chicago Tribune reported no police deaths, but a 12-year-old girl and 10 policemen were injured. The Tribune, however, did not report that the police indiscriminately charged into private residences and that the police beat a number of women and children with clubs, even though they weren't arrested. Even after the gunfire started, the tenants of the building still refused to let the cops enter, and the gunfight lasted 2 hours. The gunfight at Henry Horner Projects represents the culmination of a community's anger at police brutality and the ineffectiveness of the Daley government. The community near the Henry Horner Projects began organizing to place a stoplight at the corner of Washington Boulevard and Hoyne Street prior to Soto's death. Prior to the stoplight's installation on September 19, 1969, two children were killed at the dangerous intersection since the fall of that school term. Despite the installation, community activism sparked what activist Wakiti Eel termed a wave of terror from the police force over the west side of Chicago. Wakiti Eel and other concerned citizens formed the Committee to End the Murder of Black People to protest police brutality. In fact, both Soto brothers, prior to their deaths, marched with that committee. According to the defender, Michael Soto had been arrested during one demonstration for the life-saving stoplight and charged with disorderly conduct. To many in the Black community, the murders of the Soto brothers did not happen by accident, but the police carried them out in a deliberate assault on community organization. Even if many in the Black community did not join the Panthers, they adopted Hampton's solution to demonstrate in Chicago and, in the phrase of Hampton, protect our crib with gun force. Lastly, state violence carried out against other people from different races in Chicago drove the ability of the Chicago Panthers to create coalitions across racial lines. Namely, the violence, the Daley machine that they exercised against New Left activism and its culmination at the 1968 Democratic National Convention gave the Panthers and poor whites in Chicago an easily identifiable enemy on which to build an alliance. In the locally funded documentary, American Revolution II, released in 1969, filmmakers Howard Alk and Mike Gray captured scenes from the protests outside the DNC. They then transitioned to the founding of the Rainbow Coalition. The first section, titled A Few Honkies Get Their Heads Beat, displays the violence the police used against the primarily white peaceful protesters in Chicago outside the convention hall. Police even attempted to hit the cameraman at one point in the documentary. Although rarely mentioned in most accounts of the DNC protests, race, primarily the fear of black power, influenced much of Daley's and the Chicago Police Department's actions. According to Jacoby Williams, Daley had the Chicago Police Department's subversive unit use secret informants to obtain information from out-of-state organizations that he viewed as a threat to the convention's proceedings, focusing especially on the Black Panthers. In preparation for a race riot agitated by the Panthers, Daley wanted to prohibit demonstrations outside the DNC. In fact, Daley explicitly gave an order for police to not let a peaceful march led by comedian Dick Gregory cross 18th Street because he thought the Panthers, from that point on, would cause a riot. And that's where some of the most violent episodes that were caught on camera were seen. Although some Chicago Panthers participated in the protests, the National Black Panther Party had not officially recognized the ILBPP chapter at the time of the DNC. Early efforts to organize by its founders had only started within a couple months before the convention, and the events surrounding the future Black Panthers shaped their tactics for organizing. After the DNC protests, the documentary American Revolution II shifts into a dialogue among Chicago citizens about race, poverty, and police brutality. In a pool hall, several African Americans, a couple wearing the outfits of Panthers, voiced their frustration to the cameraman that the press only started paying attention to police brutality once it also happened to white people. Some African Americans also recognized a potential ally in some of the poor whites who experienced police brutality, although not to the same extent as the African American community. In uptown Chicago, poor white migrants, mostly from the Appalachian region, often found themselves living in depreciating housing, struggling to make ends meet, and frequently harassed by the police. Within the same documentary, many poor whites recollect memories of cops beating and arresting and threatening them. One white person stated that one cop threatened, "You look, you son of a bitch and hillbilly, I see you out on the street again tonight, I'm gonna blow your head off." Once many poor whites formed the Young Patriots organization, which imitated and supported the Black Panthers, police harassment only increased against them. The specific historical context of the Daley political machine's police brutality influenced the rhetoric and actions of the Illinois chapter of the Black Panther Party. Of course, police brutality also played a role in the decline of the ILBPP, but the Panthers rarely attacked police officers outside of self-defense. The Daley political machine fought against the Panthers with all of its usual tactics and force, terrorizing anyone who spoke of changing the system. Hampton's assassination represented the ultimate example of subversive activities by the Democratic machine in Chicago. The Rainbow Coalition politics directed against the Daley machine, however, matured through the rest of the 20th century, turning into an official election strategy which eventually defeated the Democratic machine. Daley's reign as the boss of Chicago's political machine ended with his death in 1976, but that did not necessarily mean that the machine died with him. Division within the Democratic machine ended the cohesion and collective strength of the party. Meanwhile, Harold Washington began campaigning for mayor in 1980 using the idea of the Rainbow Coalition and building off of the networks that the Black Panthers had created, which eventually helped him win the election in 1984 and become Chicago's first African-American mayor. As in the words of Fred Hampton, you can kill the revolutionary, but you cannot kill the revolution. Thank you.